Let us pray. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. Psalm 9:1-2. Jesus, we love you and worship you. We dedicate our lives anew to you today. Amen.
Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Romans 5:1-2. Let us bow our heads and confess our sins before God. Our Heavenly Father, in his infinite mercy, has sent his only Son into the world for your salvation, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. Therefore, by the authority of Jesus Christ and in his name, I declare to you that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The first reading is from Isaiah 45:1-7. This is what the Lord says to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I take hold of to subdue nations before him and to strip kings of their armor, to open doors before him so that the gates will not shut. I will go before you and will level the mountains. I will break down gates of bronze and cut through bars of iron. I will give you hidden treasures, riches stored in secret places, so that you may know that I am the Lord, the God of Israel, whom summoned you by name. For the sake of Jacob, my servant, of Israel, my chosen, I summon you by name and bestow on you a title of honor. Though you do not acknowledge me, I am the Lord, and there is no other. Apart from me, there is no God. I will strengthen you. Through you, though you have not acknowledged me, so that from the rising of the sun to the place of its setting, people may know that there is none beside me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form the light and create the darkness. I bring prosperity and create disaster. I, the Lord, do all these things. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is for Thessalonians chapter 1. Paul, Silas, and Timothy to the church of Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you. We always thank God for all of you and continually mention you in our prayers. We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospels came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit and deep conviction. And know how we lived among you for your sake. You became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. And so you became a model to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message ran out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it, for they themselves report what kind of reception you gave us. They tell how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and the true God, and to wait for the Son, for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. Word of God, word of life.
The Gospel of the Lord from St. Matthew, chapter 22. Then the Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap him in his words. They sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. "Teacher," they said, "we know that you are a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You aren't swayed by others, because you pay no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay the imperial tax to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, "You hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax." They brought him a denarius and he asked them, "Whose image is this and whose inscription?" "Caesar's," they replied. Then he said to them, "So give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's." When they had heard this, they were all amazed. So they left him and went away. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Well, good morning. It's good to be with you again, 2 weeks in a row. And for those of you that were here last week, I say hello again. For those of you that may not have been, my name is Gary Greco. I've been able to be here at your church now about 5 times over the past year, and it's an honor for myself to be back. My wife Kelly and my son Adam are here with me also this morning. As Pastor Jim and his wife Jill recover, he needed a few weeks off, and he asked me to come last week, and I offered to come a second week if he needs so, and here I am. So it's good to be with you this morning. A lot has happened in my life and my family's since I saw you last week, as I've continued to pray for Pastor Jim and his wife, as I trust that you have also. We've been looking forward to the end of October was the due date for my daughter and son-in-law's first child, which would be our first grandchild. And this Thursday morning, we received word that the doctor said at a regular visit that it was time and sent her right to the hospital. And after an entire night and almost 24 hours of labor, on Friday morning at 11:19, our grandchild, Jordan Elizabeth, was born. So we're very thankful for that. Praise the Lord. I know I look way too young to be a grandfather. And I work in youth ministry, so we're going to have fun together, that's for sure. The unfortunate thing with the COVID environment we live in, and she ended up having to have a C-section, so she's still there. We have our bags packed. They live outside of Philadelphia, about 3 hours away. So there is a chance when we leave this morning, we're heading, if we get the word, she's coming home today, or they're coming home. So we're very excited to hold our granddaughter in our arms and to love on her and our daughter and son-in-law. So keep us in prayer. I would like to take a moment to open us in prayer. So if you would join me, that would be great. Heavenly Father, we just praise and thank you for this Sunday. Lord, we do lift up Pastor Jim and Jill. Lord, thank you for their leadership in this church. And we continue to pray for their recovery and for them to feel well. Lord, may they feel the love of this congregation. Lord, as Pastor Jim returns this week, I pray that he can take it easy and feel support and know that he just needs to follow you and any doctor's advice. Lord, for this church, for any concerns that are in the congregation, we lift them up to you, Lord. You know each concern. You know what we face this day, and you know what needs exist. But Lord, may we also exalt you and lift you up in all of our ways. I'm thankful, Lord, for my beautiful little granddaughter that is born, for my daughter and son-in-law. And Lord, we have many blessings to be thankful for, all of us. And help us not to dwell on the hardships of life and the difficulties, although they are important and something to learn from. Lord, we also give you praise and thanks for the blessings that come, big and small. So Lord, just be with us all this morning as you've laid on my heart something to share. May we be open to your words, not the words of my mouth, but of your speaking to our hearts and minds. And we thank you in advance in Jesus' name. Amen. I also want to remind you, if you weren't here last week, that I am the executive director of Youth for Christ in the area, and things are going well. We also had a very busy week with YFC, and looking forward to the schools in Carroll County are opening up tomorrow. Maybe you know that. We're up here in PA, but in Maryland, most of the schools have been closed and been virtual learning. So as they return, that changes part of our ministry approaches. So we're constantly changing our approaches to reach young people. So your partnership and prayers are truly vital, and we are so thankful of those. Well, last week when I was here, I shared, and again, knowing that probably there's at least a few people that might not have been here, when I look into Scripture, I like to consider that they are not just stories, but they were true accounts of things that happened a long time ago. But last week, as I read and led through Mark chapter 2, we talked about Jesus and the paralytic that was led to him by the four friends of his and the faith that they exhibited. And well, as I was praying where to go this week, I'm going to just go a few more chapters into Mark and have a similar approach with you this morning to say that they were not just stories. And the two stories, illustrations that Jesus, the occurrences, were astonishing just as much as the paralytic being healed. So as you think of these and as I read them to you this morning, I want to encourage you to try to place yourself in the situation. Imagine what it would have been like. I think Scripture sometimes becomes something that we know so well that we know them as stories and we imagine it, but to imagine as if we were in the occurrence takes a little bit different picture. And that's what I challenge you to do this morning as I read to you again. Well, before I get into Mark chapter 5, which is where I'm led, I'm going to take a look from where I left off just last week in Mark chapter 2, healing of the paralytic. at that time, as it says in the beginning of it, Jesus was traveling around from town to town, and he was preaching, teaching, and he was healing. He was doing amazing and astonishing things. And as I pointed out in that first part of chapter 2, crowds would follow him. I mean, could you imagine? I mean, it's one thing if a pastor or somebody comes and he speaks somewhere and there's a crowd around them, but then when it's time to leave, it would be like, you just follow me from whatever I'm going to say. That would be weird for you and for me, right? But that's what happened with Jesus. He would talk, and then they would follow him to the next place. And he had crowds around him all the time because they had never experienced a person such as Jesus. So this continues on, and he's continuing to do teaching and preaching. And in chapter 3, once again, we see that the crowds are following Jesus. I'm going to read just a couple verses there, and starting at verse 7. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him to keep the people from crowding him. I read those cities, and although you may not know all the geography, people came from quite a distance to hear about Jesus, to see him, to touch him, just to be in his presence. People were traveling, and keep in mind, they didn't jump in the car and head there. It was a long journey, but he was an incredible figure to be seen and to be around, so the crowds were always around him. Jesus had kind of a plot. He needed a break occasionally, so they would have a boat so that they could just get away and rest and have some time with a smaller group of people. So we find out that he did that in chapter 3. Well, moving on just a little bit from that particular chapter, and in 3, there were a couple more things that he did. We find out this is when he appointed the 12 apostles. He called them to be him. In Mark specifically, he had already been doing much preaching and teaching and healing, but in chapter 3, we hear of the 12 that were appointed to be his apostles, to be his disciples. Not long afterward, in chapter 3, we read about Jesus and Beelzebub, a demon. Can you imagine if this is chronological in order, the disciples start to follow him and they hear about all this stuff going on from the crowds, but all of a sudden they're around a demon-possessed person and how Jesus deals with that situation. In chapter 4, most of the chapter is dealing with some parables, as we know that Jesus taught often in parables. I also like to look at parables as a word picture in a way, that he talked in illustrations that they could understand, that they could comprehend. Like, for example, the parable of the sower. And, and then it goes on, he's teaching about the lamp on a stand and how it is used. It's an actual item that every one of them would be familiar with. Next would be the parable of the growing seed, and then the parable of the mustard seed. So that, in pretty much that whole chapter, he's teaching people in words and illustrations they can understand. And then we get into chapter 5, where I'm led today. It starts off with Jesus healing a demon-possessed man, and the one where he casts the demons out into the pigs, and they go off of a cliff, and they drown in the river below. Again, imagine what it must have been like for the disciples and the people following him to see these things. He heals a paralyzed man that was maybe paralyzed all his life in front of them. He teaches in words that some of them understood and some of them had no idea what he was saying, but they were still in awe of him. I'd like to pick up in chapter 5, verse 21, and that's what I want to share in detail with you. I'm going to do the same thing I did last week. It's almost like a two-part series of Jesus doing astonishing, miraculous things in front of common people and the ways that they responded. So starting in verse 21, and I'm going to dissect it as I read it to you. It says, "When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake." Once again, lots of people all around Jesus. He's not by himself. "Then one of the synagogue rulers named Jairus came there. Seeing Jesus, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him. Now keep in mind that Jairus was one of the leaders in a synagogue. We're not sure exactly what his role was, but he clearly was a leader, and he goes to the feet of Jesus, and as it says, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him. Now the scene of that must have been astounding even in itself, because leaders and the Jewish highbrow type of people, they didn't bow down to other people, common people, especially Jesus, who at this point was known as a teacher and a man who had done a lot of amazing things. They weren't really understanding that he was the Son of God at this time, but Jairus goes and falls at his feet, pleading earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. That's all we have of the account until a few sentences later. He pleads with him, and Jesus, it says, he goes with him. Well, then there's like a pause in this story, a pause that something else happens while Jesus, with a crowd all around him, is heading to Jairus' house to see the little daughter. Something happens. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. Remember last week, if you were here, I said when they were in that house and the paralytic was lowered, they dug a hole in the roof and lowered the paralytic down to Jesus. It was like everybody was crowded because there was no room in that building. Well, similarly, Jesus is walking, and I can't imagine he had long strides because there were people all around him, in front of him, behind him, to each side. Large groups of people follow him everywhere. It must have been challenging. A large crowd followed him and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. Now, this may remind you, a lot of you know, I'm familiar with that one. Well, think of this. Jesus is walking. There's people all around. It's smelly. There's animals. There's noises. There's all kinds of things happening. This lady was in the crowd, and she had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. Something that stuck out to me as I studied and prepared for this was when it said she suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors. 12 years. So this was not just a common occurrence that happened to her or an illness, but she suffered, and it says many doctors attended to her. Many tried to help her, but apparently none of it worked. And she had suffered for 12 years with this issue of bleeding, which would be a very difficult thing to deal with. She had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she got worse. Her illness was continuing to get worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. Now, you think of that, it almost seems a little creepy in today's terminology. She comes behind him, but she had heard Jesus was coming into the area that she was in. Now, we don't know if she traveled a great distance, as we heard just a few sentences before, but she heard about this Jesus who had did incredible things, so she thought, I need to get to him. I need to see him. And he's walking with people all around, and somehow she maneuvers her body to get close to him and reaches out, and scripture says she grabbed at his cloak. She didn't touch his hand or touch his face or a foot. She just touched his cloak. Because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Wow. We talked last week about the faith of the four friends, not even necessarily the paralytics, and how that was such an incredible thing to Jesus. This lady, she didn't even intend to touch him physically, but to touch his clothes, that somehow that would help her to be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. Now, other people around, if you were in that crowd, probably wouldn't have recognized anything happening. She knew that she had been sick and tremendously sick for 12 years and suffered greatly and had this faith that if she could just get to Jesus and not even bother him, but to reach out and touch his clothing, that she would be healed. And the Bible tells us that that is exactly what happened. if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. What a tremendous faith that this woman had. And then I love what scripture says in this version, immediately, not well after a while, or, you know, eventually, but immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. So then it goes further. Remember, Jesus is on his way to Jairus' house to tend to a little girl who was dying, and this happens on the way. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" He knew something happened. It wasn't, I don't even fully understand, and maybe you do better than I, but her faith in touching his clothes caused immediate healing, so she felt complete relief in an instant. But Jesus also, in that moment, felt something from within him go into somebody else. I'll read it again. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" The disciples are around him. They're probably kind of like his bodyguards. They've gotten it by now that everyone wants to see Jesus. Everybody wants to get a piece of Jesus, so to speak. So they're around him and trying to protect him, but crowds are pressing in and pushing. And when he asks, "Who touched my clothes?" the response was this: "You see people crowded against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you asked, 'Who touched me?'" I mean, it seemed like a silly thing for them, right? Jesus, why would you ask that? There's people everywhere. Anybody could have touched you. It could have been me bumping into you or an animal or whatever. That's kind of silly, Jesus. They don't say that, but it seems like that's their intent. But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. At this point now, she feels like, because she could tell that Jesus was searching for who had touched her. Maybe she even heard. She had to be close if she touched his clothing. And he's asking, "Who was it? I need to know who it was." She was fearful because maybe she felt selfish. Like, I just thought if I could touch him, I could be healed. And she felt that healing. So she was trembling in fear in front of Jesus at this point. And she told him the whole story. And now Jesus, I guess she's anticipating and worrying, is he going to scold her? Is he going to condemn her? What is he going to do? This is the words of Jesus and how he responds. "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Now, if you were hearing that, probably so many people were still not aware it was happening because it was a conversation between two people, and it wasn't something like the paralytic where it was in front of a mass of people, although there were people all around. The few that were hearing, maybe they knew of her condition, maybe they didn't, but Jesus, in his merciful way, filled with grace, says to her, I have to believe, in a loving way, "Daughter." Just acknowledging her as daughter, that meant a whole lot. We don't know much about her at all. We don't know her age and what she was suffering from, but we know she was a woman, and he calls her daughter. "Your faith has healed you." He acknowledges that it was faith in her, of him, that caused this healing. "Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Jesus knew that she had suffered for such a long time. Maybe he didn't even know she was in the crowd because he seemed surprised that it happened. Was he making an example of this lady similar to what he did with the paralytic? Maybe, maybe not, because there may be only a few people that even knew what was happening. But the thing here is, unlike the paralytic, in front of so many people, there were people witnessing it. In this case, it was Jesus and that woman, and maybe just a few others around, that the faith of this woman in Jesus caused her to be freed from 12 years of misery and suffering. While Jesus was still speaking, so now we turn back to this, to the road to Jairus. Jesus was still speaking. Some men came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead." Now we're back to the scenario. Jesus and Jairus is heading towards the house. We don't know the distance, but it had to be somewhat of a distance. And Jairus, I mean, I just shared with you the birth of my grandchild and the love I have for her and for my daughter and the fact I can't wait to go to see her because she's our daughter and we just want to hold her and we want to love her and we want to see that little baby. Well, the scripture says that this little girl was 12 years old and Jairus was going to get Jesus out of desperation to get him to come and maybe help to heal his daughter, just like what happened with that lady. And people came out and says to Jairus, some came from the house of Jairus, your daughter is dead. Right away, the pain and the suffering is just escalated to a very high level. And then they said, why bother the teacher anymore? They give Jairus the news, his daughter is dead. Don't bother the teacher. He has surely many more things to do. She's gone. I can imagine tears and suffering and wailing at the loss of his daughter. If you could just put yourself in that situation, it must have been brutal. In verse 36, it says, ignoring what they said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, don't be afraid, just believe. Just those few words that Jesus says to Jairus, don't be afraid, just believe. I'm trying to imagine as a father what it would be like to be with this Jesus that you've heard all these incredible things about. You want so desperately to get him to your daughter. You find out that she's gone, but then Jesus just says, don't be afraid, just believe. I don't know how he reacted. Scripture doesn't really say it, but that's the word that Jesus said. Did he feel comfort? Did he feel okay during that time? In 37, it says, he did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue ruler, which is Jairus, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. I just mentioned that earlier. When the word came to Jairus about the death of his daughter, surely he must have felt horrible at that time. They get to the house and we all can imagine the human emotion of a young child dying in front of us and the pain and the suffering. And it says there that Jesus hears the wailing and the crying, and it's so loud, and then he goes into them. Jesus goes in and says to them, why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep. Now, can you imagine what they must have thought? They saw her die in front of them. And surely they didn't know the difference between dying and sleeping, but that's exactly what they're thinking. Jesus is saying, "What? She's just sleeping." This is what they said. In my version, it says, but they laughed at him. Now, I can't imagine it's laughter like, ha, 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 ha. I mean, they must have almost mocked, like, are you crazy? What do you mean she's just sleeping? We saw her die. It must have been the commotion changed from sadness and grief and wailing to, is this guy really the person you wanted to bring here? What's going on? Can you imagine what it would be like to be there? I almost can't. I'm just reading what Scripture says. After he put them all out, Jesus removes the people from the room, the ones that were wailing, the ones that were crying, and says, I need you to step out right now. Leave the house for me. He puts them out. He took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him, and he went where the child was. He took her by the hand. Can you imagine the scene now? It's just the disciples who mom and dad don't know who they are. They heard about Jesus. Now the crowd has been moved. Aunts and uncles and townsfolks and all that, they're moved out. It's now become a more intimate situation. But still, the disciples are there. It had to be somewhat odd. He put them out, took the mom and dad and the disciples with him, went to where the child was, and he takes the little girl by her hand, and he says, Talitha koum. I hope I'm saying that right. Talitha koum, which means, little girl, I say to you, get up. Now, the disciples knew what that meant. The parents knew what that meant, and he's saying to a little girl who's in front of him that has passed on, has died, get up, little girl. I say to you, get up. And here's what Scripture says. Immediately, the girl stood up and walked around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. I know I'm in church and I'm up here at a pulpit, but I want to say, wow. Can you imagine what it would be like to have a little girl who you love and is there and who has died, and he says just those mere few words, and it says immediately she stood up and walked around. That's a wow moment, folks. That's a Jesus moment that we really can't explain and understand. That is something where faith comes in, that we have to examine ourselves to say, do we believe that, or that is just one of those stories and illustrations that really didn't happen? I have to tell you, I really believe that Jesus healed the paralytic in this circumstance. I have to tell you, I believe that the woman who was bleeding for 12 years by reaching out and touching Jesus was healed. And I'm going to tell you, I believe that the little girl was gone. She had died. And by Jesus' touch of her hand and the words that he said, she stood up and lived. Wow, that's the Jesus we serve. That's the God that we pray to. That's the God that we believe in. And the thing that we understand, this is what brings the story of last week and the paralytic and the two illustrations and stories of today of the woman who was bleeding and Jairus' daughter, was that there was faith exhibited, not just common and simple faith, but faith that changed insurmountable things. Death, paralyzed person, a person who was suffering for all those years. And faith was the factor. It wasn't, when I read Jesus says, and the power came out of him, he knew that power came out, that sounds almost mystical and magical and so on. No, the fact is that God had that ultimate authority and power to heal. Also, the fact is that the people who pursued him had faith that he could do it. They were not the ones that were, as we've read in the gospel, trying to trap him. They were around also, but in front of common folk people like me, maybe some of you, he did things in front of them that was incredible. That's a faith factor, guys. That's something that makes me think, do I have faith like that? I want to say that I do. I believe that I do, but to see God do these astonishing and miraculous things, would change my life and these people's lives for all the rest of their life. But not just them, those in the community had to hear about the woman, even as she returned to her town and said, I'm healed by the touch of Jesus' cloak. Or Jairus to say, my daughter was dead and Jesus touched her and she was alive. The word got out and people continue to have faith, faith that grew to this day, that we exhibit and we have. And just wrapping things up here, because I said to you last week, I'd like to take a moment to say, how does Scripture apply to us? What is there in Scripture that we can apply? Well, and I won't read the whole chapter, but if you're not super familiar with it, I encourage you to. In Hebrews chapter 11, many call it the faith chapter, but just in the beginning, it defines for us what faith is. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understood that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. That verse, verse 1 especially, is really challenging to understand, because we as humans, a lot of us, maybe not you, but a lot of us, we need to have some evidence to believe in things. Do you realize when you came in today that you exhibited faith and you didn't even realize it probably? When you sat in the chair, how many of you looked underneath the chair and checked the bolts and shook it to make sure you'd fit? I'm a pretty big guy and I just plopped right down in that chair there. And that's faith. It's faith that that chair was going to hold me. When you go to your car later and you turn the key, you're going to have faith that the parts will work, that the car will start to take you wherever it is you're planning to go. Those are simple elements of faith. The element of faith that's in Jesus, that he is God and he has the power to heal and the power to do miraculous things, can be the same simple faith. Sometimes we as Christians seem to put it on a different level and to say, well, have that kind of faith. I'm just not that much of a Christian. I don't know the scripture that well, so I'm not sure that I have that kind of faith. But you have faith to sit in a chair and it's not going to drop to the floor when your body hits it. It can be the same faith, a childlike faith, knowing that he is God and that he is the amazing Son of God, Jesus, and that he has the power and authority to heal any issue or problem in your life. I challenge you this week to consider, as the week goes on, the simple things of faith that you do. Just consider it. I gave you the illustration of sitting in the chair. When you go home, when your wife makes you lunch or supper, are you going to make sure there was no poison in it? You're going to have faith it's going to be okay, right? We are going to exhibit faith all the time. Are you exhibiting faith all the time without ceasing that your God loves you and that he's the creator of the universe and he has the ultimate power and authority? He knows every hair on your head. He knows every part of your life. He knows tomorrow and the last day that you'll be here on this earth, and he's prepared heaven for each and one of us. Or are you weary? Are you not sure? That's my challenge for you this week. We've given you some illustrations. I'm so glad your pastor will be back with you next week, and I continue to pray for him. But I hope that you consider these stories in Mark, maybe revisit them, chapter 2 through 5, and it continues on, how God and Jesus is so able. We ought to have faith. Can I pray? Father, thank you for what we read in your word. Lord, may we look at those occurrences in a different way. Lord, maybe that's the thing that challenges us today, that instead of just reading words on a page, rather we place ourselves in the circumstance and imagine what it must be like to be among you when you do these miraculous things, when you exhibit that you are truly God. And Lord, as we go upon this week, as I travel with my family to see my brand new little grandbaby, Lord, help me and our family to know that that was a part of your design, that you knew that little Jordan was going to come, and you know what she's going to do in her future, and you know the same for every one of us. May we have a faith that is similar to Jairus. May we have a faith that is similar to the lady that just reached out to touch his cloak. And may we place that faith in everything we do, as little as the food we eat and the travel that we have and the chairs we sit upon. May we that much more have faith in you, that you are God and you are sovereign and you are good and you love each one of us and have a plan for us and a purpose. No matter our age, no matter the sufferings in our lives, no matter the joyous occasions we have, you have our best interest at heart. You desire us to be in relationship with you and to love you as you love us. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. unexplainable lie. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me.